Hello everyone. There are very few personalities more divisive and contentious in India's contemporary political history than Vinayak Damodar Savarkar. For many, he is a nationalistic hero, the founder of the idea of Hindutva. And for others, he's a coward, a political opportunist. So what is Veer Savarkar's rightful place in Indian history? Is he worthy of India's highest civilian honor, the Bharat Ratna? To discuss this, we're joined at the Sahitya Aajtak English stage by political analysts and historians on both sides of this divide. Let me start by introducing Irfan Habib. He's the author of Inqilab, Bhagat Singh on Religion and Revolution, Indian Nationalism, Essential Writings. Flanking him is Ashutosh. He's written a book on Hindu Rashtra. Nilanjan Mukhopadyay has written a book on the RSS icons of the Indian right. To my right is an advocate, RSS thinker, Deshrat Nigam. And flanking him, we've got Vaibhav Purandare. He has written the true story of the father of Hindutva. This is a biography of Veer Savarkar. I want to start this conversation by touching upon the relationship that Veer Savarkar had with the RSS. And I want to ask Vaibhav first, why is it that a man who, during his lifetime, had such a fractured relationship with the RSS, under whose leadership the Hindu Mahasabha actually published a series of editorials hitting out at the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh and was never a member of the RSS because he thought it was too small and unworthy of his time. Why is it that today, 70 years after independence, Veer Savarkar is one of the greatest icons of the RSS, far greater than your original founding fathers?
There are two, three reasons for it. One is that Hedgewar, the founder of the RSS, was inspired by Savarkar's 1921 tract called Hindutva. That was the inspiration for the founding of the RSS. So that is the so-called holy text for the RSS. That's one reason. The second is that the RSS would certainly like to have somebody who is a freedom fighter and somebody who's gone to jail, the Andamans, the worst of jails in British India, as an icon. And the third is that his concept of Hindutva, to a certain extent, also matches that of the RSS. He disagrees strongly with the RSS on their notions of science or scientific development. Like, for instance, Savarkar would never agree that Indians had nuclear weapons at the time of the Mahabharata, because he believed in science and technology, and genuine science and technology. At the same time, he believed in reconversions. He believed in violent reprisals against Muslims, if necessary. And he believed in a sort of Hindu assertiveness that the RSS believes in.
Deshrat Nigam, you know, the RSS is always accused of appropriating icons of the national freedom struggle. Why is it that a man who, during his life, was never a member of the RSS, is one of the greatest icons of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh?
I don't think RSS ever insisted anybody to be part of RSS or be a member of RSS. You were free not to be a member of RSS. In fact, you know, the so-called membership of RSS is very informal. You go and become a part of Shaka and you become a member of it. So there is no, any strict rules or regulations to be a part of RSS. Yes, Hindutva philosophy is there for the RSS.
But I'm only referring to historical writings which talk about how there were members of the RSS in the 20s and the 30s who invited Savarkarji to join the RSS, and he, A, did not accept that, B, later chose to take leadership of the Hindu Mahasabha. So whether you say it's formal, informal, he was invited to join the RSS and yet he chose not to.
No, that's his prerogative. You know, we've invited many, many, many people. Some wanted to be a part of it, some didn't want to be a part of it. That is the informality with the RSS. Even that continues till this day. And his, what should I say, it's his his favoring violence as a means of achieving an end was not, was a part of RSS philosophy. That was one thing that the RSS deferred. And also his philosophy of Hindutva only including Jains, Sikhs, and the other ones who are actually offshoots of Hinduism, and not including Muslims and others as a part of the Hindu concept, is also a difference that RSS has. RSS includes anybody who's born in this region is a part of a Hindu fold. So those were the basic differences. Yes, but remember, when he died, 2,000 RSS Swayamsevaks gave him a salute in a march pass during his funeral. So we did respect him a lot. And there were ideas, and probably his ideas in the beginning of the last century were ahead of his time. The concept of Swadeshi, the amount of work he did in the field of untouchability were things, you know, maybe they were not accepted at that point of time, but they became a foundation for India's freedom movement in subsequent times and even for the RSS.
Irfan Habib, Deshratra Nigam says it's not so consequential whether or not he joins the RSS. He created the idea of Hindutva Rashtra, and therefore he continues to remain one of the top icons of the RSS.
No, for me there is, I'm not surprised, because RSS has been appropriating icons from far away. Forget about Sarvarkar. Sarvarkar is very close to them. As Purandare said, Hindutva actually inspired RSS. So I'm not surprised. I'm surprised when RSS goes and appropriates Sardar Patel, appropriates Subhash Chandra Bose, appropriates Bhagat Singh. So this appropriation is not something very, very, very surprising. So that is happening. And that all depends, that all actually happens because there is actually no icon to venerate.
Does this hurt at the core of the being of the RSS, Deshrat Nigam, that there is no genuine RSS Pracharak or Swayam Sevak who was a nationalistic freedom struggle icon?
Because my point is, let me complete. There is no icon to take to people, to India, to Indians. You know, somebody who can really be an inspirational figure, cutting across caste, communities, religions, etc. So there is nothing like that. There is not a single personality.
Let me answer that. What you call appropriation by RSS, what I think it was a neglect of 70 years of not giving due importance to Sardar Patel or others. If somebody gives due importance to others, you say RSS has appropriated it. So that's the basic difference between appropriation and giving due importance. The RSS or the present regime is giving due importance to the people who should have got their rightful place in Indian history. Hegdewarji, Gwalkarji, they were icons in their own right.
No, but I don't understand. But you, just let me.
When in 70 years, when they write their name from the books of history, do not give any importance to them, and then you say they were not national icons, that is a problem. I say they were national icons, but you ignored them. You obliterated them from the history books, because it was the left and the Vampanthis who wrote the history books. And for them, anybody who was non-left had nothing to do.
This is something which is being propagated unnecessarily. I don't want to see these names in the books. I want to see these names in the National Archives files. You know, the files which actually give us the history of the freedom struggle against the British. These names should figure there. They don't figure there.
I'm not bothered about textbooks. They are all there, textbooks, but you've got to see it.
Textbooks can be partisan.
No, let me ask you this question. You know, you had Dr. Hedgewar who set up the RSS. You had Guru Golwalkar. Why doesn't this current dispensation and the RSS of this time push for the founder and his successor as the main icons? Why are you pushing for somebody who wasn't even in the RSS as the preeminent Rashtravadi right-wing icon?
RSS has never pushed for anybody. Let us be very, very clear.
No, I'll tell you why. Because there's a demand now that Veer Savarkar be given a Bharat Ratna. Why not Hedgewarji or Guru Golwalkar? I'm trying to understand this from the RSS's perspective.
See, the fact is, Hedgewarji and Guru Golwalkar themselves were against accepting any awards. They were very clear in their philosophy. They don't want anything in return. And it is a part of their record and philosophy. They themselves, you know, is the kind of people, and in fact RSS is an organization which continues to work on the ground without seeking publicity. 171,000 service projects going on in and quietly going on the ground, whether it is in Dalit bastis, whether it is the legal aid that they do it or legal advice they give it to in the poor colonies. Not many people know, but our work is going on. We do not, you know, aspire for anything in return. Even RSS, it's the BJP which brought its Veer Savarkars in the manifesto. Yes, we think that he deserves. He deserves, and the kind of contribution he gave in the freedom struggle, both from the revolutionary context and
so
otherwise.
So Ashutosh, the right alleges that the likes of Veer Savarkar never found their rightful place in Indian history because history was written on the left. And because history was written from a left-leaning perspective, the flaws of the right-wing national icons were highlighted and their successes and achievements buried under a carpet.
See, this understanding comes from the two things. One is sheer inferiority complex. And second, the revengeful nature of the politics. These are the two very, very important factors. When you're talking about Savarkar, see, even if you compare Savarkar with Hedgewar and Golwalkar, you will realize that Hedgewar and Golwalkar pales before Savarkar. Though Savarkar himself, if you compare Savarkar 1896 to 1910, I think was one of the brightest nationalists ever. Very, very bright. Savarkar turns into a different personality altogether after he was arrested and sent to the Andamans. And since then to 1947, when he was arrested for the 48, when Gandhi's assassination, it was a different Savarkar altogether. The difference between the RSS and the Savarkar is very clear. Savarkar is the ideological fountainhead of RSS. RSS means organization. RSS means submerging your individuality into a collectivity. That's what Savarkar and that's what the RSS is. Savarkar was more political. Savarkar was thinking and was talking about the present. RSS was planning for the future. So the difference, the RSS at one point of time did realize that you cannot take your ideology forward unless you got some icons. Like RSS till 60s, 66, 67, was not even given much importance. Then they found Atal Bihari Vajpayee, his charisma was used, and now in 2014, Mr. Modi is there. So when they realize that they are a colorless figure, they believe in the collective leadership, but it is not taking them forward. So then went back to their charisma. Maybe in you can also analyze the Ayodhya movement in terms of the taking the Ram's charisma as a big personality, and behind that they push their agenda. Then they also use Atal Bihari Vajpayee to get credibility in the eyes of the Indian people. And Atal Bihari Vajpayee never associated himself directly with Ayodhya movement. And now Mr. Modi is there. Now he was just talking about last 70 years. Last 70 years also include the 6 years of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. That means in the 6 years of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Savarkar was never given its due.
Vaibhav, do you want to respond to Ashutosh's assertion that the RSS suffers from a historical inferiority complex? And a lot of what we are seeing right now, an attempt to rewrite history, is an attempt, it originates from a historical sense of inferiority.
Ashutosh seems to have made a political statement, and since I'm not into politics, I'm not going to...
I'm also not in politics. Was.
But, I agree to some extent with Mr. Nigam that so many heroes of the Indian freedom movement were written out of India's history books, deliberately so, because successive Indian governments wanted to highlight only a particular family, I can say that actually, a particular dynasty, because of which, whether it was Patel, whether it was Bose, whether it was Savarkar, whether it was anybody else, or you know, they were practically wiped out from the history books. Okay, now when you try to monopolize Indian consciousness in this manner, when you are out of power, and your history writers are no longer in the ICHR and other institutions, the others are going to do the same thing. That does not mean it's justifiable. But the backlash is going to happen.
But you can't take away from the fact, Mr. Habib, he venerates largely a very limited sect of leaders, mostly associated with the Congress family. family and the Gandhi family. And if you look at the likes of an Ambedkar or the likes of a Sardar Patel or a Lal Bahadur Shastri, they haven't had as much of amplification of their achievements as the Gandhis have. That's a reality. You can't run away from that.
My problem is, and I say it again and again, there are lots of things which the Congress party and the different governments did over the years which they shouldn't have done. No? Lots of things. But the point is, the people who are trying to make a cause for themselves now, they can't hide behind the weaknesses of all these governments. Because you have no record of your own. Because somebody else didn't really give you a chance. No? Or somebody else projected their own leaders, which I don't agree with. But that is no reason for you to actually make your case. Because your case stands absolutely independently, which is a big zero when it comes to freedom struggle.
Okay, so the RSS, Mr. Nigam, was a big zero when it comes to the freedom struggle. Forget what modern day historians are saying. Irfan Habib says, show me the National Archives. What role did the RSS play, or which icon of the RSS was genuinely a member of the RSS played any role in helping India achieve its
goals? Another thing, let me add one more thing before you start. I had several discussions on TV channels and otherwise also with people from the right who have been accusing the left and the liberal historians, so-called. The point is, who actually told them not to write their brand of history? I have been actually a university teacher with no support from the government for my own interest. Whatever I wrote on my own. Not that some particular government okay, asked me to
do. So let him respond to the charge that the RSS was big zero when it came to India's freedom struggle.
I'll start from 1917. Dr. Hegdewar, when he was a part of the Congress movement, I would not call Congress as a party. Congress is a movement where every shade was a part of that independence struggle. There, Dr. Hegdewar, for the first time being in charge of the volunteers looking after the security of the meeting, propounded the concept of complete Swaraj freedom, which was rejected by the working committee of the Congress. The differences arose. Then he formed in 1925 the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh. Twice he went to the jail, not written in history, one in Jungle Satyagraha in Wardha and in 1921 in the non-cooperation movement, and it happened. Nowhere shown in the history, 2 years of jail he had to go through.
It is that.
So which history books and
before
show me the instances before the founding of the RSS.
Interfere,
you will have your rebuttal. Did not read it in class 12, till class 12, then I became a science student. Nobody heard about that. His contribution, the contribution of the RSS in 1942, the entire Congress was against Quit India movement. So was RSS at that point of saying that it will fizzle it out. But still it was launched. RSS participated and hit a lot of people trying to save them from Britishers. Please read Aruna Asaf Ali, who said she had to take a refuge in the RSS leader's house, and number of people in Delhi, they were the underground part of the setup and were coordinating and controlling the movement.
So
and there are more. Look at Andaman and Nico, that Dadar and Nagar Haveli, when it was liberated, the role of RSS Swayamsevaks. The Goa liberation, the role of RSS. Then look at 1947 when the tribals and the camouflaged army of Pakistan was attacking. They were the ones who provided the underground spying network and protecting the Srinagar airstrip, and 200 Swayamsevaks died and continued that airstrip to remain open, the only link with India. The moment the instrument of accession was signed, the Indian army landed there and started pushing. And I can give you examples after examples
to
where it is not being shown in the history.
All the illustrations cited by Deshritan Nigam about role that RSS activists, Pracharaks played, which left-leaning historians never highlighted. And therefore, he says that the RSS never found its rightful place in liberating India.
Rahul, there are a couple of things which are getting intermixed. One is that we began by starting to talk about Sarvarkar and the basic dichotomy as to why, despite the fact that Sarvarkar in his lifetime had nothing to do with the RSS, what is it that the entire Sangh Parivar has gone on a huge embrace of Sarvarkar, not just in 2014, just a minor correction to what Ashutosh said. Even when Mr. Vajpayee was the Prime Minister, 2000, he made a very concerted attempt to give the Bharat Ratna to Sarvarkar, which was turned down by President K.R. Narayanan. Thereafter, the Lok Sabha Speaker, Manohar Joshi from the Shiv Sena, took the initiative at that time to get Sarvarkar's portrait installed in the Central Hall of Parliament. So it is not that Sarvarkar has not been embraced prior to 2014. We got to understand, also look at the timeline as to when did the embrace of Sarvarkar really begin within the Sangh Parivar. Let's go back a bit to the years after the Gandhi assassination. You had this, the Hindu right was completely, you know, stained, if I can actually use the word. Sarvarkar himself had been in jail. Many of the top RSS leaders had been in jail. There was a ban on the RSS. So they were basically coming out of that period, at which point, you know, when the Jansangh was set up, essentially to legitimize itself in the political space in the independent country. At that point, any association with Sarvarkar was very bad news. If you go and look back at the last phase of Sarvarkar's life, he virtually died, you know, the period from 1950 to 66. Nobody wanted to do anything with him. The process of embrace begins much later on. There is that much touted, you know, letter written by Indira Gandhi. Then the national, you know, the documentary which she ordered by the Information and Broadcasting Ministry. Indira Gandhi, being a very smart politician, she was, you know, at that point embracing just about anybody and everybody, including from the right, because she knew that the RSS was one of her targets, and the RSS and Sarvarkar did not have a very harmonious relationship. That is a reason as to why you had a situation that Indira Gandhi began to promote the memory of Sarvarkar. I'm not saying promoting Sarvarkar, but the memory of Sarvarkar. Projecting what we keep on saying, the pre-1911 Sarvarkar. The point is that if you are actually doing an assessment of Sarvarkar, you have to see that his life can be neatly dissected into three phases. Prior to 1911, when he is a revolutionary, when he writes the book on 1857, a very important, you know, contribution in the study of Indian history, calls it the First Indian War of Independence. Along with Karl Marx, he's the only other person who gives it that name. 1911 to 1937, that's a period when he's in jail in various forms, either in jail or in Ratnagiri, where he's allowed to travel around. But that is the period when he becomes a guru of Hindutva. Thereafter, he becomes a politician and he fails miserably in that. If you look at the, prepare a political balance sheet of Sarvarkar, you'll find that the RSS is trying to project and embrace him for what he did prior to 1911. Whereas their heart really wants to honor him for him being the Hindutva guru, the political pandit of somebody who codified Hindutva as a political strategy, who created the idea that there can be a Hindu political constituency. How various people have been treated in history is a completely different matter. The moment we get into it,
it brings up
a lot of whataboutery.
Okay, so let me come now to the crux of the role that Veer Sarvarkar played in India's freedom struggle. Desh Ratan Nigam, the charge is, and to some extent the reality, that the greatest revolutionary zeal was shown by Veer Sarvarkar in the first phase of his political career. This is prior to 1911. Subsequently, and especially post his incarceration at Andaman and Nicobar at Kalapani, he's largely been A, writing mercy petitions. At least four mercy petitions are cited. And B, when he comes back to Maharashtra, he's involved in social reform and has very little role to play in the freedom struggle that was engulfing India at that time. So therefore, if India got freedom, it's no thanks to Veer Sarvarkar.
See, the mercy petitions was a part of his strategy to come out. In fact, if you look at his third mercy petition, where he laid down the entire roadmap for India's independence, which was rejected by the British, saying he's far more dangerous and he should remain inside, and they thought of releasing his brother and not him. And that is a part of record in the London archives. And his mercy, the third mercy petition also said, please release everybody else, not necessarily including him. That's also a part of the London archive. So one has to be very, very clear as to what his motive was for mercy petition, to come out and actually to contribute. But when he came out, finally, in 21, there were a lot of restrictions imposed on him. He was not allowed to take part in the any political movement.
Do you buy this theory?
And Ashutosh, it's also a part of record.
The mercy petition as a tactic to ensure that he
and
didn't
that
end
was
up
also
in
used by Shivaji.
Again.
The exact tactic was used by Shivaji as well.
That's why I said the whole the narrative is built around the deep sense of inferiority complex. Subhash Chandra Bose, he wanted to take part in Indian freedom struggle. There was restriction on him also, but he went to Japan and he created a Azadin Fauj. Who stopped Savarkar from going an underground, going out of the country and do something else? In fact, I just
that's a very wrong reading
of history. When he was feeling threatened, when he was told in 1909 that the police will be coming and arresting you in London, then he had gone to the Paris. So who's
and he came back. He came back.
He was arrested. He was on
so
a ship.
I'm saying he stayed there till 1937. Did nothing. Why? Who was stopping him? Nigam Sahib was saying that RSS took part in the freedom struggle. There is a historical documented evidence that Golwalkar has said RSS will not take part. That's a historical document. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee at that point of time was a deputy chief minister in Bengal, who was from the Hindu Mahasabha. He wrote a letter to the English governor saying that this freedom struggle, this Quit India movement, has to be crushed. And he writes also how it should be crushed.
This debate is getting centered around the RSS.
I'm just putting the historical facts together. Golwalkar has also said that in 1930 and onwards, though it is because of the Satyagraha movement, ki hamara jo youth tha wo digbhramit ho gaya. Now this is, somebody has gone and hidden, Arun Asapalli has hidden in somebody's house. If that is your claim that you took part in the freedom struggle, that is your claim you took part in the Quit India movement, please tell me, except Hedgewar in 1930 and 31, when he had gone to jail. When Guru Golwalkar has gone to jail fighting for the freedom struggle, when Shyama Prasad Mukherjee had gone to jail, I want to know that. None of their stalwarts had gone to the jail because they did not take part in the freedom struggle. And in fact, in Hedgewar in 1930, he said, I am going in my independent capacity. None of the RSS guy will go that.
I want you, Vaibhav, to compare and contrast what right-leaning historians say is a tactic of writing those mercy petitions with someone like Bhagat Singh, who many now in the right tend to think of as a great nationalist, who when he was facing the gallows and his father wrote to the British seeking mercy for Bhagat Singh, he hit out at his father saying that I do not want mercy. I will go to the gallows. Compare and contrast this with Veer Savarkar, who not once, not twice, not thrice, but on multiple occasions is writing lengthy mercy petitions.
Okay, allow me to explain. You know, I am not a right-leaning historian. I'm somewhere at the center. I'm non-partisan, but I'm not neutral. I have my positions.
I'm also not left-leaning historian.
I wasn't referring to you as left-leaning. poor Anna Hazare is feeling, must be
I
feeling
know,
bad
I
in
know.
Maharashtra. But I come from Maharashtra, that's why I said
that. I have a deep respect for Anna Hazare.
Yeah, yeah. It is unfair, I think, to compare freedom fighters in this manner. You know, Savarkar versus Bhagat Singh, Nehru versus Savarkar, Gandhi versus Savarkar, etc. Let me explain, okay? There are clearly two Savarkars, like Nilanjan said. I completely agree.
Three Savarkars.
Okay, you would say three, I say two. You know, one until 1921 and one after that, you know. One is an outstanding revolutionary hero. The second is
1911 to 21. He's not a revolutionary
outstanding
hero.
Sorry,
1911 to 1921. In my reading,
he is, in my view. I'll tell you why.
Who he is contesting?
Now there is this
one. No,
I want to say.
One second.
Okay, I'm not.
No, one second. One second.
So
one second. If we pipe in like this, the whole conversation degenerates and we serve no purpose. And I hate noisy news channels. Okay, so we'll do this one at a time and we'll try and make sense, not noise. You have an opportunity and allow you to complete. Go on.
When we talk about Savarkar's mercy petitions, let us look at the situation in cellular jail in the Andamans. This is Kalapani, He is kept in solitary confinement for long stretches of time. He is made to do impossible tasks. One of the punishments that he suffers is something called as standing fetters and chain fetters, which means you are chained to the wall, your hands you have to hold up, both of them, they are chained there, and you stand there with your legs spread because there are iron bars here, and you stand like that for 8 to 10 hours a day. You are not allowed to go to the toilet, even to relieve yourself. So many freedom fighters, Sarvarkar included, they soil themselves in that prison cell of theirs, and they stand in their filth, okay? But they are not allowed any sort of relief, okay?
One moment. Sir, you didn't answer my question, so I'll ask the same question to this.
No, I am answering your question.
You need to do it faster, just say mercy petition.
Look at the context.
You need to respond to the question that's being asked.
Yeah.
Because Deshrita Nigam, the question that was asked was this. You say that the mercy petition is a tactic, and Shivaji used the same tactic. I'm comparing and contrasting this with Bhagat Singh, who the modern right tends
compare.
To.
You cannot compare.
One second.
It's so unfair.
For the reason that when his father was seeking mercy for that young son, Bhagat Singh is telling the world that he doesn't want mercy. Respond to this.
Let me tell you, can you compare and call Gandhi a coward when he says be non-violent? Can you compare that strategy with a violent revolutionary of Bhagat Singh saying no, he's a militant? Please remember, it is in their own context and time. Mahatma Gandhi's way of non-violence was a different strategy. Similarly, Bhagat Singh's strategy was a different strategy, and Veer Savarkar's strategy was a different strategy, but the goal was same. Goal was independence of India. Therefore, that comparison is unfair, absolutely unfair. They were relevant in their own point of time and in the context of the then situations prevailing in the country.
Rahul, I just want to counter that. See, when Weber was saying that he was, yes, that did happen, but Sarvarkar was not the only one. There were more than 500 people. There are more than 500 people. And when Sarvarkar was writing these mercy petitions, there are more than 300 revolutionaries from Bengal and other area, and they were so angry, so livid, and they thought that Sarvarkar has compromised on that issue. And in fact, many of them, they stayed in that jail for more than 30 years. So what about them? Nobody talks about them.
Fair enough.
Nobody talks about them. You always term the Sarvarkar suffered. Sarvarkar did suffer, but also others.
And if they would have also written a letter,
would have also asked for the mercy, they could have also come out because they also had a family.
But
they refused to do that. They suffered and died. Many of them died in that. What about them?
Aurobindo Ghosh's brother, Barindra Kumar Ghosh, was in the same jail.
Talk about them also.
He wrote a mercy petition the same way that Sarvarkar did. Satendranath Bose in 1908, when Khudiram Bose and all that happened, they wrote mercy petitions. They were hanged. But we do not call them traitors, and we are correct in not calling them traitors.
Similarly, I
may agree or disagree with Mr. Nigam's assertion that it was a tactic. Even if you think that he was completely broken, he was human, he was an outstanding revolutionary freedom fighter, he was a hero to millions of Indians, including Aruna Asaf Ali, her husband Asaf Ali.
Okay. Gandhi said
that the evil of the British Empire,
the
he understood
that
before.
The atrocities that were meted against Sarvarkar broke him while he was at Kalapani. And therefore, when you look at his life post-incarceration, you have to also consider what all he suffered at Kalapani. Neither Gandhi nor Nehru suffered the same kind of brutal atrocities.
You see, these are all very unnecessary things. Well, Nehru.
So now the comparison is not right. Okay.
It is unnecessary.
No, I agree that the comparison is not right, but the comparison must not be right there in every case. Not just in the case of.
Well, I've asked Irfan Habib to respond. Let him speak, please.
Compare the people who were in cellular jail. No?
Yeah.
Compare those. Who were with him, what others did.
So others have also suffered, of course.
Second is the whole issue of tactic. If it was really a tactic, then what did he do when he came out?
No, I'm not saying it's a tactic.
He should have thrust himself into freedom struggle.
Assume it broke him.
This is a good point that Irfan Habib makes. Since Deshrita Nigam made that point, respond to Irfan Habib. If this is what you say Shivaji did as well, but when Shivaji retreated, he regrouped and fought back. Unlike Veer Sarvarkar, who retreated, went to Ratnagiri, largely changed his attention to social activities, dealing with issues like untouchability, never came back and fought the war.
See, but that is because of the, you know, undertaking and restrictions that were imposed on
him. How is that Shivaji then?
No, I'm not saying, I'm only saying as a tactic.
No, you said Shivaji did the same.
No, as a tactic.
Actually, Sarvarkar has written about why he did this. He has written about why
he did. As an apology, asking for a mercy.
No, you drew the parallel with Shivaji in the context that he came back and fought again. But he didn't.
Why did not disappear?
Let me.
Why did not disappear? That's my point. Why did not disappear?
No, there are, see, people have various theories about how to fight their fight. Okay. Sarvarkar's theory was, okay, I cannot practice politics. Let me go out and do whatever I can for my society. So he started social reforms. Now, we may agree or disagree with him. I may also disagree with him. I disagree with him on so many things, or like his Hindutva, his violent reprisals theory.
Nilanjan wants to come. Yes.
You know, I think what is happening is that we are completely forgetting what was the focus of Sarvarkar in his political, whatever political intervention he wished to do after 1911. Prior to that, you know, when he's a revolutionary, he's definitely, a keen freedom fighter wanting to fight the British regime, trying to throw them out and get freedom for India. Once he goes into cellular jail, he becomes the advocate of Hindutva. He codifies Hindutva laws. You know, he says that the political Hindu. So his basic purpose is thereafter to strengthen Hindu society. He's no longer fighting for freedom of India. He's basically wanting to strengthen Hindu society. And in terms of, you know, what is he, who is he really fighting against? He's fighting against indignities against the Hindus in history. So his enemy becomes, from an outside force, it becomes very much the enemy within. He is the one who creates the concept of the political other. You know, the political other, which is constantly, you know, being pointed out even today, that he is the person who is actually against India.
See, I think that the mercy petition is a slightly smaller thing. The bigger thing is the Sarvarkar's role in the freedom struggle. After, in 1942, when he aligns with English, with the British
that's
government.
That's not true. That's
so you cannot
that's
forget
absolutely
what he did.
Wrong.
There is a resolution in
Hyderabad also.
Absolutely.
There is a resolution passed in the Hindu Mahasabha in 1942. There's a resolution, there's a documentary evidence. Then Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was part of the government. He was a Hindu Mahasabha's representative. He aligned with Jinnah's Muslim League. So that's a part of it. When in India, the Indians were fighting for their freedom struggle, when they were going to the jail and they were suffering all kinds of torture, Sarvarkar as Hindu Mahasabha was recruiting people for the British army and saying, this is the time we should go. And there is the exact
okay,
what
let
I just
said. Let Nigam respond
to let Sahaja, me answer.
So, and then Sarvarkar should also be assessed in history what was his role in the Gandhi's assassination. Let's not forget that. No, he was arrested. It was Ballabhai Patel, their icon, who was the Home Minister. And when Shyama Prasad Mukherjee protested that don't take a political recourse, he said, I will judge every file and only then I'll ask for the orders. And then he asked the IG, who was looking into the Gandhi assassination, and the files were put before him. Once Ballabhai Patel was convinced about it, only then he gave orders to arrest him and do all kinds of things. So let's not get into that. Mercy petition is a small thing. I granted that it was a tactics and all that, granted. But what was his role in Gandhi's assassination? What was the role in 1942 freedom struggle? Please answer that.
Let me first answer. I can be more practical than rather rhetoric as...
I'm never rhetorical, I'm always go by fact, disprove my fact if you can.
1942, when Sarvarkar said that please join in the Indian men, the British army, the Indian army, the whole entire purpose was to get a huge body of Indian men trained
Hindu
under the British,
Hindu men,
so that they can be a tool of revolution tomorrow. And that is why he said, we wanted, because there was no other system of Indian men getting army training. Therefore, Sarvarkar said, please be a part of this, the Indian army, so that tomorrow you can be a part of Indian freedom.
So I'd like to quote to you what Sarvarkar wrote at that time. One second, sir.
No, writing and strategy.
When Mahatma Gandhi launched the Quit India movement on the 8th of August, 1942, Sarvarkar urged all members of the Hindu Mahasabha to boycott it. He writes, and I quote now, Hindu Sabhaites, who are members of municipalities, local bodies, legislatures, or those serving in the army, should stick to their posts across the country and not participate in the movement.
Yes, he opposed Quit India Movement, and 99% of the Congress itself opposed Quit India Movement.
No.
But Gandhi prevailed over everybody. Please remember, everybody said, "Quit in." Please don't interfere. I never do that. Please don't. The fact remains, Gandhiji prevailed over the entire Indian Congress and said, "Quit India Movement has to be launched." And everybody said it will fizzle out. It actually fizzled out. It failed, badly failed. We all know that the entire Congress leadership, the working committee, was opposing it, and so did Gowalkar. The time was not ripe at that point of time to launch Quit India Movement. And it's a part of record that the Congress, a lot of senior leaders at that point of time,
that they opposed Quit India Movement. When the Quit India Movement was launched by Mahatma Gandhi, there were those in the Congress who did not like the timing and the idea.
You see, I'm really surprised that today, as RSS spokesperson here, or RSS generally, they talk about their role in freedom struggle, and they refer to the problems within the Congress party, the differences of opinion with the Congress leaders. Those times,
it's a historical fact.
They were part of the freedom struggle. They were facing all those problems, fighting the British. What were you doing?
We now all, want to sit despite the fact it was opposed, RSS took, once it was launched, RSS took part in it.
You have
like
no,
everybody
you have no
else.
Talk about Sarvarkar, Quit India, and Sarvarkar and Gandhi's assassination.
Purandare, let me add.
I'll answer the assassination. It was left out.
Rahul, there was an exhibition in Nehru Memorial Museum and Library when the government took over in 2014. Exhibition on Shyam Prasad Mukherjee and his contribution to Indian freedom struggle and modern India. I went there. There were about 20-25 panels. I took a round. I challenge, even today you can go and check the panels, they might be lying in the stores. There was not a single panel where you can find Shyam Prasad Mukherjee being part of freedom struggle or any movement. All of them were either Hindu Mahasabha activities or some social reform, some lecture somewhere to Hindu community leadership, leaders, etc. There was nothing at all to do with freedom struggle.
Okay, so I want to deal now for a few minutes on something which many people find very troubling. Veer Savarkar's linkages and his apparent or supposed admiration for a Nazi fascist worldview. There is an Italian researcher by the name of Marzia Casolari who collected many of Savarkar's speeches, and he says, and I just quote from some of them, you know, Savarkar's deep appreciation for Hitler and the Nazi philosophy. There is a quote which apparently is part of a speech by Veer Savarkar where he says, and I now quote, "The very fact that Germany or Italy has so wonderfully recovered and grown so powerful as never before at the touch of Nazi or fascist magical wand is enough to prove that those political isms which were the most congenial tonics their health demanded." This is what Savarkar is believed to have said. He goes on to publicly criticize Jews for failing to absorb into the German national fabric and compared them to Muslims in India as well. And in 1939, at the 21st session of the Hindu Mahasabha, Savarkar says, and this is again from Marzia Casolari's writings, "The Indian Muslims are on the whole more inclined to identify themselves with Muslims outside India than Hindus next door, like Jews in Germany." Now, respond Desh Ratan Nigam to the supposed
Rahul,
deep admiration for Hitler and his Nazi philosophy.
Can I just add, Rahul, to what you said, you know, not just Savarkar, but also B.S. Munje and Hedgewar were equally very appreciative of the efforts of the Italian and the German fascists. And it's part of the same research which you have quoted.
Hedgewarji died in 1940, and Hitler's rise became somewhere about that time. So Hedgewar had nothing to do with Hitler. Or the opinion about Hitler or this thing. Now let me point out one thing. Subhash Chandra Bose took help of Nazis or the Hitler and the Japanese. Why? He was not a Nazi. Because he wanted to have an enemy of British on India's side for India's freedom. And exactly the same attitude Savarkarji had to praise them and to get some kind of a benefit to have that opinion building at that point of time so that their assistance could be taken through others also.
So you're
kind
basically
of
saying don't take anything Savarkar wrote very seriously.
No, he had a strategy. He had, no, let's be very clear.
Rahul.
He had a strategy in mind. Rahul. We don't call Subhash Chandra Bose as a Nazi because he took help of Germans and Japanese. because that was for the larger aim of India's freedom struggle.
Okay, Irfan Habib,
let us remember, let us keep
Bose
the context.
Bose also fought with the Allied forces.
I may disagree with what Bose did in the end. I may not like him to associate with fascists, etc. That's a different issue. The point is,
it becomes a different issue.
You can't compare him with Sarvarkar. You are insulting Subhash Chandra Bose if you compare him with Sarvarkar.
No,
because
no.
Subhash Chandra Bose, fought all his life.
No,
he's a British. In the end, he founded something in collaboration with the fascists. That has nothing to do with.
Please understand.
What are you saying?
An enemy's friend is your friend.
Give me the
profile. That's the logic.
But you need to respond, Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay. You need to respond more seriously to the charge that if Subhash Chandra Bose allied with the fascists, that's a brilliant military strategy. If Veer Savarkar, he says, tactically praises the fascists, he's calling it a tactic and part of his strategy. Nilanjan.
I know, I'll say something very controversial, especially given the fact that I also happen to be a Bengali. Not everybody in India on what is said to be the other side of Indian politics agree that what Subhash Bose did was possibly what the medicine which Indian nationalism needed at that stage. I think that there are many things which can be questioned about Subhash Bose also, and we must do that with an open heart, because when we scrutinize history, let us not make anybody a hero or a villain. Everybody has grey shades.
But Deshdanigam, from what I've read of Subhash Chandra Bose, there is very little to suggest that he's othering the Muslim community or talking about how, you know, you need to take action against them, or that there is only one culture, one community. There is nothing like that in his writings or in his speeches. Whereas if you look at, and you know, you're talking about Nazism as a magical wand, you're talking about his admiration for Hitler and the Nazi philosophy, you need to respond to that. Comparing him with Subhash Chandra Bose isn't an adequate response.
No, I said that could be. See, I was not born at that point of time. But understanding his love for the nation, love for the country, the only conclusion that could be drawn as a part of strategy to help others to take the, you know, help of the Nazis at that point of time. Because
when you say don't look at his speeches, you are almost making us imagine things he meant to have meant, and you are saying you're not born over there. How do I know this is what he meant?
No,
maybe he really meant what he wrote.
See, that is what I'm saying. If nobody questions his nationalism and patriotism, Veer Savarkar's, then the only possible conclusion would be, and rational conclusion would be, that he had a strategy in mind. Are you saying he was anti-India?
No, but where did he elaborate on this strategy? How do we know there was a strategy and not genuine admiration for the Nazi cause?
The fact is, there were restrictions on him. He could not have written. He could not have participated in a political movement at that point of time. So, during 1940 to 45, whatever happened in the world, it was...
This is a reality, Irfan Habib, that there were restrictions on what he could write and say.
Not
the British were monitoring very carefully what he was writing
there,
and saying. Which is why a lot of what he wrote was couched in a certain way, because the British would clamp down on him and incarcerate him.
Before 1937, why are we mixing dates? He is talking about 42, 44.
Okay,
whereas let's talk
he
about
He would have again gone to Kalapani.
He would not have gone to Kalapani in 42 because not fighting the British. He was only fighting the Muslims.
He was very
all
close,
he was interested in to strengthen Hindu society so that
on him
the Hindus could take revenge on what the Muslims had done in the past.
Please let me respond.
I'm
very close, very close watch was being kept on him on what he wrote and what he said. So his way
I do
was,
not think you, know, you will
way
find
was
any British.
In a very
there is
oblique.
No British intelligence.
So why do you
report?
Intervene? You don't allow me to answer. No, please.
No, you this just is unfair.
This is unfair.
You know, first they accuse the left of writing history. Now at least let the right speak.
I'm not the left.
You're sitting
the
on the left.
The left calls me right. The
you're
right calls
on the
me left.
Left. Okay.
So the fact is, you should give him that great patriot and a national hero of utilizing the circumstances in a manner that would benefit India and defeat British. That's a strategy. Brilliant people do, you know, use such kind of strategy in a manner so that the aim and objectives are finally achieved. Whether the person gets credit or not is immaterial to him. He was such a great person. He never bothered
but
about
it. There is a war being fought.
I just want to know.
The ultimate war of India's independence. Veer Savarkar at that time, at that crucial moment, is not fighting that war. That's the reality. That is the historical reality. When the British were being evicted from this soil, Veer Savarkar, sir, at that moment wasn't fighting the war. What he did prior to 1911 is a different matter. And you're calling him brilliant in having helped India secure freedom.
In a strategy. writing such kind of things.
No, I think strategy. We, you know, yes. This is a completely...
No, but strategy for what? I want to know. See, but strategy for what?
Why is
see, Rahul, why Rahul, called, I think when we are comparing Subhash Bose and Sarvarkar, I think let's make a difference.
Let's have
as a biographer, Ashutosh, I would like to state certain things that I've noticed. Okay, one is I want to talk, respond to Dr. Habib, who's a renowned historian, that in 1937, when Sarvarkar is finally released from all kinds of captivity, Bose sends him a message and releases a message to all of India saying there is not a single Indian who will not be delighted that this revolutionary freedom fighter has been released. Okay, that is, you know, so it's not right to say, you know, we shouldn't compare Bose and Sarvarkar, etc. That's what I feel. You may have a different opinion on this. Second is, Sarvarkar's politics is such that he keeps floundering from time to time. So at one point in time, he praises the Nazis. Then he decides.
Do you believe his praise for the Nazis was real or not?
It may have been real, absolutely. So he.
You think it was real? It wasn't like as Deshwar Nigam says.
No, he keeps struggling.
So he's used the word may.
Similarly, similarly, Bose's outreach to them was real. So you know, one moment. So he then he does demonize a section of Indians. He leaves them out of the ambit of Indian nationhood. Then he also starts working with trying to work with the British. Then he why does he ask Hindus to join the army? I would not think that it's for the revolution. I differ with him. I think it's because he saw Hindu-Muslim conflict coming and he wanted Hindus to be in the army in strong numbers because Muslims were in a majority at that time. Okay. So, and he keeps struggling. And
you know, this is
and
also
he's
not
lost
a
as a politician. He's completely lost.
So this
and
is
I think he completely lost his way.
Once again, you know, you just very casually got away by saying that Muslims were in a majority in the Indian British Army.
Yeah, that's true.
No, once again, sir. There is no historical record to suggest that
you have not read it.
Rahul,
you have not read it.
Read what?
The historical record which states that Muslims were in a majority at that time.
When?
Where? When the Second World War started.
Where?
In the army.
I haven't read that.
They hopelessly outnumbered the...
There are numbers.
There are numbers. Okay, don't read my book. Read Srinath Raghavan, who's a noted historian. I'm talking about tactics. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. Why don't you understand? This is what I'm saying. You know, do not dismiss, just rubbish without knowing the facts.
I'll concede that point.
Let's fight with facts.
But for me, the assessment of the Sarvarkar will take place whether why he was involved in the Gandhi's assassination.
Okay, so we just have a few minutes to go. We just have a few minutes to go. I'll start with Ashutosh. I want to focus in the last few minutes on the alleged role that Veer Sarvarkar played in the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. The RSS says, the BJP says at this point, that courts acquitted Sarvarkar, that at the end of the day, when history judges and looks back in time, there is no evidence to prove in a court of law, not in books written by left-leaning historians, that Veer Sarvarkar actually had a role to play in the conspiracy. I'll start with Ashutosh.
See, there are the 3 points. And firstly, RSS always said that since court has acquitted him, court has acquitted on what ground? The court has acquitted on the technical ground because there was a gentleman, Narayan Vadge, whose witness was considered to be truthful witness by the local court and then by the Shimla High Court also. But since he being a government approver, he did not have another concurrent viewpoint confirming his witness. On that ground, he was given a clean chit. Not this. Second point. No. Please understand. When the Kapoor Commission was formed and the Kapoor Commission has given its verdict, he found him guilty. Found him guilty because other than the Narayan Badge, one of his bodyguard, his name I'm forgetting, and then his secretary, they confirmed what the Badge was saying. And that is where Kapoor Commission has found him guilty on
so
that.
So both the bodyguard and the typist said just before Mahatma Gandhi was assassinated, Nathuram Godse came and met with Veer Sarvarkar. This is before documents in the Kapoor Commission. Respond, Deshwatanik.
See, let me tell you, I'm a lawyer too. I'm a lawyer, I think the only lawyer on the panel. And when the court says there is no evidence on record to connect Veer Sarvarkar with the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi, how do you read it? Not the way Ashutosh wants to. Justice Ashutosh wants to read it.
No,
that's
I think you should. See, you, I think being a lawyer.
Just hold on. Keep your thought to yourself for a moment. So the fact remains that you cannot be sit here and become a justice and say the court record, which goes through strict laws of evidence to see whether a person is guilty. There has to be a clear and categorical evidence that this person was either directly involved, indirectly involved, or was a part of controversy. Not an iota of evidence on the court file on record, those records are available, those judgments are available, says that there is any iota of evidence of Veer Savarkar's involvement in Mahatma Gandhi's assassination. But subsequently, Kapoor Commission comes. What is the sanctity of a Kapoor Commission? Is it a court of law? Is it a politically appointed commission under the then Congress government to have its own narrative?
Okay, so respond to this. Nilanjan Mukhopadyay. No, one second. No, Ashutosh. Allow me to be fair. You've been an anchor earlier. Pehle mic utha le. No, cheating. Everybody has to get a fair chance. No, so one second. Nilanjan Mukhopadyay. The Kapoor Commission is accused by members of the RSS as being a political attempt to try and somehow pin the responsibility of the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi on Veer Savarkar.
And bypass the due process of law.
Wasn't the Kapoor Commission first known as the G.S. Pathak Commission and appointed by Lal Bahadur Shastri, the Prime Minister of India who has been marginalized by the Nehru-Gandhi dominated Congress?
So this is something that we need to, answer.
So when
this is neither here nor there.
When it is a good Congress, then it is fine. When it is a bad Congress, then it is not fine. I think this kind of a double standard
assassination, specifically on assassination.
No, it was appointed by Lal Bahadur Shastri. So that is the point which I was trying to make. And the same Prime Minister who is being now embraced, whose legacy is being now said to be as among the better Congress presidents, a Prime Ministers than Nehru and Indira Gandhi. But what for me, what is more important is the long 15-year-old, almost a 15-year-old relationship which was there between Nathuram Godse and Savarkar.
Even the RSS doesn't dispute that there was a relationship between Nathuram Godse or Savarkar. No, what needs to be established is, before Nathuram Godse went to assassinate Mahatma Gandhi, did Savarkar say, go ahead and do this?
Nathuram Godse
just
the
fact
editor,
that they
was,
met
was
before the assassination doesn't prove that he was part of the conspiracy.
Nathuram Godse was the editor of a paper which was funded by Savarkar. They had regular ties right from mid-1940s. Till the time Gandhi was assassinated. So you have to understand that there was a history of political consultation between them. You cannot become an editor of a paper and be funded by somebody at that particular time, a newspaper like Agrani. You know, very important. And you know, there has been a regular consultation. We also have to look at that. What is Jeevanlal Kapoor Commission saying? That it is very difficult to understand. He's not saying that there is proof. It is very difficult to understand that Savarkar and his friends were not in the know of the plan to assassinate Gandhi.
Okay,
see,
so
Rahul, just 30 seconds. See, I think Deshra Nigam has said that he's a lawyer and who was heading the Kapoor Commission was a Supreme Court justice. So if Justice Kapoor has said something, I think as a lawyer you should respect that.
Nathuram Godse's newspaper has the name of Veer Savarkar on his masthead. They hold regular consultations, and if what the bodyguard and the typist say is correct, that he met just hours before the actual assassination of Mahatma Gandhi, you know, that does raise the question ki kya dal mein kuch kala hai.
See, that would be curiosity as to what he discussed. What he actually discussed, nobody would know. So courts would strictly go by evidence on record. Here we can sit down and speculate as to what he could have discussed.
So it is Irfan Habib, at the end of the day, speculation. Whether in that last meeting or before, Veer Savarkar knew about the plot to assassinate Mahatma Gandhi can only be a matter of conjecture and no definite proof. I need to wrap up with all this
background and all these controversies which we are discussing today, which are not so pleasant and not so good in the context of a name like Mahatma Gandhi and his assassination. I don't think Bharat Ratna anyway should come anywhere close to it, close to Savarkar. Because even if it is speculation, it is something bad. We should keep somebody like him away.
No? Okay, because so let's conclude on this note of the Bharat Ratna. Now, this is the reality. Now, whether or not in those meetings, the actual plot to assassinate Mahatma Gandhi was discussed or not, can never be proven. As you said, you weren't born at that time. The reality.
I was not part of the discussion even.
But the reality.
I was born much later.
But the point was.
None of us were.
I was also not born then.
Yeah. Okay.
But the point. One second. But the point is, and that's the point that Irfan Habib raises, that we know that the assassin of Mahatma Gandhi looked at Veer Savarkar as a ideological fountainhead, and there are multiple controversies surrounding him. Therefore, why do you believe that Vinayak Damodar Savarkar is worthy of a Bharat Ratna?
Rajiv Gandhi got Bharat Ratna. You remember 1984? All of us remember 1984. If he gets it, then Veer Savarkar is 100 times more credible to get Bharat Ratna.
If respond to this.
Irfan. Absolutely wrong. I 100% agree.
No, what did Rajiv Gandhi do which makes him worthy of a Bharat Ratna?
Absolutely wrong. Being absolutely Indira Gandhi's wrong. Son? Absolutely partisan.
No,
well,
how?
Shouldn't have been given at all.
Oh, he shouldn't have been.
And not only Rajiv Gandhi. There are so many others in the list. Because I don't know, where will you stop? Go back to and give it to Ashoka. If you have to go back in history, then give it to Ashoka. Why stop?
No, but this is a good point. Because the RSS said the Congress committed many crimes. And therefore, there should be a different government that comes to power. Your best justification, Desh Ratan Nigam, cannot be that the Congress gave Indira Gandhi's son a Bharat Ratna. And therefore, Veer Savarkar deserves a Bharat Ratna. How can that be your best defense?
That's not my genuine reason. That was a merely comparison. So
why didn't you give us the genuine reason in the first?
I'll tell you. Bharat Ratna has to be given on its own merit of a person. His contribution to the freedom movement, what he did, he inspired many people, even to the extent of Subhash Chandra Bose also. So, if at all it has to be given not in comparison with others, but on his own merit.
Rahul.
And that will be decided by a committee. It is just a part of a manifesto of BJP in Maharashtra. And subsequently, the committee
Rahul,
will decide.
Can Bharat Ratna be given somebody? Can Bharat Ratna be given somebody who has been accused of somebody's murder? Forget about Mahatma Gandhi. Can somebody be given? There are so many people who have been exonerated by the High Court and the Supreme Court. Should be given Bharat Ratna to those?
So you hold him guilty despite the fact that the courts have found him not guilty.
Mr. Nigam, can I just...
My submission.
Bharat Ratna was instituted in 1954. I think at this time we should decide that anybody who died prior to 1954 should not be given a Bharat Ratna. Given the kind of controversy which has been there, Rajiv Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, there's no need to.
I just want to ask this question, Irfan Habib. Yeah. You say past governments have committed various kinds of offences in giving various kinds of characters the Bharat Ratna, whoever suited the political need of the time. Why should this government, which has been sworn in with more than 300 seats, not have the same right? Why is it that if, for example, the Congress government of the past thought that Rajiv Gandhi was worthy of a Bharat Ratna, the BJP should be allowed to take its pick as well?
I'm not questioning their right to do whatever they want to do, because I have nobody to question that. The point is, if you have to make a choice between Savarkar and Gandhi, you have to be very clear when you are talking about two people in one breath. One, somebody who died, who was assassinated. The other one, who is suspected of assassinating him. Whether you agree with that speculation, go by speculation. If you make a choice, that choice will define you.
Final words. The RSS also, and especially the BJP, talk so much about the legacy of Mahatma Gandhi. Many in the opposition would allege it would be the greatest disservice to the legacy of Mahatma Gandhi by giving a man accused of his assassination, of having a role in that assassination, India's highest civilian honor.
See, if you look at the political context at that point of time, there were clear indications of the government led by Nehru to be very vindictive towards the people who used to espouse the cause of Hindus. Very clear. They were against, RSS at that point of time, momentary ban was put. Subsequently, they found out they were not involved in the assassination. The ban was removed. So therefore, it has to be seen in that context of time.
Okay.
And therefore, today, if this government has a mandate of the people, can they not decide? Similarly, when the Congress had the mandate of the people, they could decide about whom to give and whom not to give. The exact mandate, and in fact, much better mandate than the recent previous governments, they also have the mandate to decide about whom to give Bharat Ratna and whom to not. This will be a people's choice, people's mandate, because that's how democracy and parliament works.
20 seconds. Bye-bye.
This is how parliament and democracy works.
Sir, let him complete. Final words.
Okay, Rahul, the Mahatma Gandhi assassination case is a problematic one for Savarkar. There's absolutely no doubt about it. There is no legally admissible evidence, but the prosecution stacked up a whole lot of circumstantial evidence, and Sardar Patel said that you know, there may be no legal evidence, but he cannot escape moral responsibility. And it destroyed his political... It destroyed his political career. It was a tragedy. And Ashutosh is wrong in blaming the RSS for defending him, because the RSS washed its hands of Sarvarkar. They completely shunned Sarvarkar, like Nilanjan had said. So that, which is what makes Sarvarkar so controversial. On the one hand, he is an outstanding national hero, and he's a revolutionary. And on the other hand, he unfortunately encouraged Godse and company a lot, which is unfortunate. And he floundered completely in his politics and did not succeed. On the Bharat Ratna, I won't say 1954, just stop giving Bharat Ratna posthumously. Because then you'll have to go back to Ashoka's time. He's right. Yeah. Just stop giving it after people die.
So when we started this conversation, this hall was largely empty. At this moment, you know, we're packed to the rafters. There isn't an inch to stand. It isn't as if we've been able to answer all the controversies and the historical questions around the legacy of Veer Sarvarkar. But I'm sure all of you who are sitting here would agree that this has been an engaging conversation. So I want to thank you all very deeply for having participated. And I want to thank these historians for having joined us on what is one of the most burning historical questions of our time, the legacy of Damodar Sarvarkar. Thank you so much to all our guests, and thank you so much.